Greetings from Cambridge, Massachusetts in the United States. I'm speaking to you from the Weissman Preservation Center, Harvard Library's Special Collections Conservation Lab. My name is Katherine Beaty. My colleague Kelli Piotrowski and I are delighted to present our work at this 18th Care and Conservation of Manuscripts meeting, though wishing we were there in person. We hope you enjoy our presentation and look forward to your questions and collaborations.
Greetings. Today, Katherine and I are going to share a multi-year project to conserve two collections of Italian stationery bindings held at Harvard Business School's Baker Library. This project was undertaken by a team of conservators, technicians, and graduate-level interns from the Weissman Preservation Center, part of Harvard Library's Preservation Services. Harvard Library has over 70 repositories, seen here in red, that are scattered around the Cambridge campus and across the river in Boston, where you can find the Harvard Business School and Baker Library. The Weissman Preservation Center, seated in the middle of Harvard Square, is responsible for the care and treatment of special collections across all of Harvard's libraries. Baker Library's special collections focus on the evolution of business and industry. Two important collections are the Medici Family Business Records and the business records of the Barberini and Colonna Families. The Medici records range in date from 1376 to 1711 and consist of 144 volumes of account books from Medici and Company, a firm dedicated largely to the manufacture of wool, as well as letter books and individual business correspondence. Dating from 1630 to 1818, the Barberini collection contains 89 volumes, pertaining chiefly to the family's banking and real estate activities in and around Rome. These include records of the Banco di Santo Spirito and the Monte di Pietà, as well as letter books and personal expense accounts. In 2011, Laura Lennard, the Senior Director of Special Collections at Baker, prioritized these collections for digitization, anticipating increased scholarly interest. Since this time, the Medici records have been the subject of lectures, workshops, seminars, and publications. Although Harvard's special collections are accessible to all researchers in a dedicated reading room, digitization will provide much greater access. Digitization takes place at Harvard Library's Imaging Services, which has a dedicated workflow for rare, unique, and fragile materials. For items with special handling considerations, such as this giant ledger, conservators work closely with imaging staff to ensure the safety of the item. Very often, a digital surrogate is not enough, and a researcher requires direct access to the objects, in which case they may consult them in the reading room under the supervision of library staff with curatorial approval. Conservators work with librarians and archivists across campus on special handling concerns for all types of materials. The majority of Medici records were bound in limp covers using high-quality parchment. The overbands were constructed of thick tanned leather or alum tawed skin, roughly a third of which were lined with paper for additional support. The spine tackets were made from strips of alum tawed skin. Most volumes had sturdy buckle and strap closures, and the book blocks were protected by wrapper-style parchment end leaves. In comparison, most of the Barberini records were bound in semi-limp covers in thin parchment reinforced with thick pulpboard. The overbands were made of lower quality tanned leather that were usually lined with paper. Spine tackets were constructed of parchment, and the fastening mechanisms were alum tawed ties, which were often broken or missing. The book blocks had no end leaves, wrapper style or otherwise. We surveyed the collection to document the binding's physical characteristics using Google Forms, an online survey tool, which allowed us to enter data simultaneously. The survey results were then exported into a spreadsheet and uploaded into ACORN, the Weissman Preservation Center's conservation database. The survey tool also allows us to easily call up bindings with specific characteristics, for example, lacings of a particular material or pattern distribution. Now to shift gears, we'd like to highlight the most common condition issues. Among the most common were losses, sometimes quite large, in the parchment covers. The Medici collection was frequently damaged by rodents, that preferentially chewed the parchment, leaving the leather overbands intact. The Barberini volumes also sustained large losses, but those were attributed to thinner, poor quality parchment. Due to environmental fluctuations, the limp parchment covers had more distortions, especially where previously damaged, such as these four-edge flaps. Most tears were situated along the folds and the joints, four-edge flap, and turn-ins. Splits in line with the turn-in folds were more common in the Barberini collection, which had thinner parchment folded around the thick pulp boards. While the pulp boards strengthened the parchment covers, keeping them in plane, they were subject to wear and splitting. Commonly, the pulp board had splits and losses along a four-edge flap, which impacted the stability and use of the binding. Some Medici had detached overbands due to broken lacings or tackets. However, overband damage was much more prevalent in the Barberini collection, where there was a decline in the quality of the leather. This poor quality leather was lined with paper and adhesive, which sometimes failed or was attacked by insects. This left the leather vulnerable to wear and handling. In both collections, the lacings were often broken the back cover. This was the most common condition issue aside from surface soil. The back cover overbands were often laced using a more economical pattern, such as a long X held in the center with a small loop. These thin strips could easily be caught and broken during use. Broken or missing spine tackets can weaken the connection between the book block and cover, potentially causing damage to other elements, such as the lace sewing supports and end band tackets. Some of the volumes were missing sections, most taken from the back of the book block. As the final leaves of the remaining text block were unused, the removed sections may have been blank and repurposed. The end bands were left vulnerable by the removal of these sections, and the thread tended to unravel from the end band core. Iron gall ink corrosion was not a major issue, except in a few cases, the most severe of which is pictured here on the left. The limited nature of the problem may have been due to a combination of factors, including paper thickness, fiber, and sizing, as well as the relatively restrained application of ink. Heavily inscribed areas on spine labels and thumb indices, on the other hand, often had fractures and dropouts.
Our goal was to stabilize vulnerable binding elements while preserving historical evidence of manufacture and use. Due to variations in the binding structures, the condition issues were notably different between the two collections, which necessitated different repair strategies. These strategies were developed and refined by the project team throughout the course of the project and were tailored to how these collections are stored and used. Every volume has its own unique challenges and required individualized solutions. We understand that other collections of stationery bindings may require a more in-depth treatment approach to address different condition issues, particularly if digital surrogates and supervised consultations are not an option. Now let's talk about some of our treatment approaches. The parchment covers and book blocks were surface cleaned with latex-free polyurethane sponges. The book block was only cleaned in the margins, avoiding inked areas. In the Barberini collections, there were noticeable deposits of black drying sands found in the gutter. We did not sweep away the sands, and instead kept it as evidence of manuscript production and for potential future research. Many volumes had paper labels with heavily inscribed iron gall ink, but spine movement caused the ink to fracture. These labels were reinforced with solvent set tissue prepared on mylar with Klucel G, which could be held over the spine to precisely cut out the desired shape. Once the adhesive was reactivated with ethanol, the tissue could be tamped in place with a small brush. A repair tissue was selected to match the paper tone, but it left a haze of fibers over the dark ink. A black-toned solvent-set tissue was used to improve the aesthetics of the men and added a subsequent layer of support to the fragile ink. This concave book block was detached from its binding, with broken supports and multiple detached leaves. Rather than removing the remaining sewing and reshaping the book block, The loose sections were sewn onto the support fragment by extending the split thong sewing supports. These extensions were slipped behind the original supports and anchored inside the section with parchment stays. The re-sewing utilized the distorted shape of the sections rather than reshaping the spine. In many cases, the parchment covers were distorted and needed to be humidified and flattened before repair. Mylar L-sleeves came in very handy for localized in-situ humidification, in this case to humidify the corner without affecting the underlying text. The L-sleeve was lined with Gore-Tex and dampened tech wipe, and after humidification, the area was flattened and dried between felts under weight. Tears in the covers were mended with alum taud gold beater skin, sometimes lined or sandwiched between long fibered Asian tissue for greater strength. The gold beater skin was toned with dilute golden acrylic paints, applied in multiple washes to achieve the right tone. Between applications, the membrane was dried on a small vacuum table. Mends were applied with a 10% high molecular weight fish gelatin. The properties of the fish gelatin allowed for application at room temperature, resulted in a strong, flexible bond, and did not interfere with future protein analysis. The downside was an extended drying time, which required some creative drying methods. We used a variety of clamps, from C-clamps to mini model-making clamps, as well as clothespins and rare earth magnets to apply pressure to hard-to-reach spots. And sometimes we just had to hold them in with our finger. As noted earlier, the turn-ins on Barberini covers had many tears and splits due to the use of thin parchment. V-hinges of lined alum taud goldbeater skin were inserted between the parchment cover and pulp board. This thin, flexible repair material was easy to manipulate around the pulp board. To repair splits in the end cap, we utilized the same technique, but the V-hinge had to be shaped to fit around the existing end-band tackets. For gaping joint splits, utilizing an over-under repair approach was effective to bring the two surfaces together and keep them in line when the board hinges. Moderate-sized losses in the turn-ins were filled with new parchment. The fill was sanded and pared to the thickness of the original and then folded and fitted inside the turn-ins. A small application of 10% fish gelatin around the edges of the fill were sufficient to hold it in place. This method worked well for the thick parchment of the Medici volumes. A template was crucial in delineating the different tones as well as matching the folds of the cover. As with the alum taud goldbeater skin, the parchment fills were toned with diluted acrylic paints and dried on the section table. Large fills, also made from new parchment, were attached mechanically by shaping tabs to fit between the slots in the lacings or tackets. The fill is slipped between the outer cover and the turn-ins. Though adhesive was applied selectively where necessary to secure vulnerable edges that would move away from the cover when flexed. Not all losses were compensated. For example, here we have a volume of two large losses, one at the head exposing the book block and one on the front cover that does not. Only the one on the head was filled to protect the book block and the end band. Splits in the pulp board stiffeners were reinforced from the back with unsized flax paper. The paper was applied with a dry wheat starch paste to reduce the risk of tide lines forming in the soft fibered board. Losses in pulp board could be filled with new board made from cast rag paper pulp. For small fills, a library of couche laminate sheets utilizing a screen and deckle was prepared by our intern, Oa Schoblom. For those cast boards, small fills could be shaped and attached with wheat starch paste. For larger losses, a coroplast jig, roughly the shape of the loss, was set up on the suction table, into which rag paper pulp was poured until the desired thickness was achieved. This, too, was attached with wheat starch paste, and thinly cast pieces of pulp were used to bridge between the fill and the original board. Overbands that were broken at the joint were repaired from the back by bridging the loss with a thick Asian paper matching the paper lining. We then built up layers of toned Asian paper to match the leather, working around the lacings and tackets. As noted earlier, one of the most vulnerable components of stationery bindings are the lacings, especially on the back cover. We wanted to stabilize what remained of the lacings, but not recreate missing components to complete the pattern. By observing patterns of discoloration, lacings could be repositioned in front or behind of each other as needed. Careful observation during the survey made it easy to determine the order and position of the broken lacings and return them to their original state. The broken lacing ends were extended with small pieces of toned Asian paper adhered with wheat starch paste. The paper was then rolled and folded around the end of the lacing and threaded into the hole from where it broke free using tweezers or a beading needle. In situ toning with watercolors helped to aesthetically integrate the extensions. Extensive damage to the lacings could also leave overbands detached. Here, another strand of twisted paper was used to reattach the overband through the original lacing holes without recreating the decorative pattern, just reattaching the overband and buckle with a single stitch on either side. Here, the original saltire tacket was broken on the outside, but the twisted ends remained in the gutter. A new spine tacket was created with Asian paper wrapped around a thread for strength. When dry, this new material was threaded through the original holes and twisted to secure it inside the last gathering. The original fragments of the tacket were left in the gutter alongside this new tacket. This technique was again utilized for missing loop tackets. Once twisted in place, localized end painting helped achieve a better aesthetic integration. In several cases, spine tackets were completely missing, leaving the book block connected to the cover only by the lace supports on the front board. Reattaching the book block spine to the cover was unnecessary, as the book could be safely handled in its condition, and the exposed spine provided an interesting glimpse into the book's structure. We would not have considered this option if objects were not carefully supervised in the reading room. A structural issue we did not attempt to alter was concave spines. These books functioned well as is, and the text was fully accessible, and we were concerned that any attempt to reshape them would put unnecessary stress on the material. Volumes missing many sections were also distorted, but in many cases these bindings were stable as is. But for some, we needed to compensate for this loss in order to protect other binding elements, such as this in-band core, which we see dangling on the left. The void was filled with a loose compensation block constructed from ethafoam covered in Tyvek. Handling instructions were included with these volumes. These stationery bindings hold a wealth of information for researchers in the history of bookbinding. Aside from making these items physically accessible to researchers, our priority was to maintain the integrity of the artifact and preserve the element of discovery that we all enjoy as conservators. While Harvard's Medici and Barberini collections are but a fraction of those in Italian archives, we were able to draw broad generalizations about the structure of bindings made in Florence and Rome during these times. At the time of our survey, the techniques that we used did not take into account the linked data methodologies that we are all familiar with today, but we hope to make the results openly available and continue to expand our collective knowledge of stationery bindings. Thank you for your attention, and thank you to Laura Lennard for initiating this project, and to our colleagues at the Weissman Preservation Center, especially all the interns and technicians who participated in this project.